Hi everyone. So I think now everybody has joined. So now we will start our session. Okay, so let's start with an introduction. So my name is Keval. I am having 5 years of experience in training. Okay, I have trained over 500 students for with and professionals in bug bounty, VAPT, malware analysis, and API bug bounty. Okay, about the hacktivists. So who are we? So we are an online information security training company. We have covered trainings in almost all the domains in cybersecurity. We have trained over 5,000 students in API testing, bug bounty, VAPT, malware analysis, Android bug bounties, forensics, everywhere. Okay, and we also provide the training in global languages. Okay, we have already provided the trainings in Hindi, English, Spanish, Portuguese also. Okay, we also take up the projects in various domains also. Okay, so normally we take up the projects for red teams, VAPT, penetration testing, and forensics as well. Okay, so recently we all know that there are many breaches happening around us. We have taken an initiative to provide the training and free webinars so that we can help you with your securing your organization or your client's organization. So here our main motto is just to spread knowledge and help you building our better community in pen testing world. You can visit us in our from our site itself. Okay, so we will be seeing our site and we'll be taking a overview over it. So this is our site. So here you can go up to the trainings and you can see all the trainings that we are providing. Okay, so we are mainly providing all the trainings in bug bounty. Okay, so normally we have started up with the API testing. Just give me 1 minute. So we have started up with the API bug bounties, Android bug bounties, iOS bug bounties, web application. Okay, and we will be also be providing the bug bounties in IoT also. Okay, except that we are providing the malware analysis training, source code reviews. Okay, so we also provide the bug bounties in source code review also training. Okay, except that we also provide the SOC, SIEM. Okay, VAPTs and reverse engineering, HIPAA. Okay, so those all are our main focus areas. Okay, except that you can go to our schedules. We will be providing you the personal demo. Okay, so normally whenever you want to learn any type of trainings here, you can go to the schedules. You can check up what is the next batch which you can join. Okay, and you can join the demo for that. Our trainers will be the one who will be contacting you. They will be giving you a personal demonstration on what all syllabus is there and an high overview of that syllabus. Again, if you are having any queries regarding or any doubts regarding your career or anything related to cybersecurity or bug bounty, we will be personally guiding you with that. Okay, so I will be sharing all these links in the chat window. Okay, so that you can have a better look on it, and after that you can after the after this particular webinar you can go ahead and you can check for it. Okay, so this is also our list of trainings which we are providing. Okay, so you can go ahead and you can check for it. It will be available in the from our site itself. Now, let's get back to our main session. Okay, so today our main objective for us it will be to check that to learn about API testing. Okay, so first of basically we will be learning what is API testing, what is security, and why it is necessary for us to secure those APIs. Okay, so for the today we will be learning, we will be having some of the demonstrations, we will be checking out what all things are needed when it comes to APIs and how as a penetration tester or bug bounty hunter we will be testing the APIs. Okay, so before going to the vulnerabilities itself, let's start with the API itself. Okay, so we will start with the basics, and after that we will be going to the complex vulnerabilities like SSRF and escalating from SSRF to some of using their services. Okay, so first of all, we will learn what is API. Okay, so basically, APIs are the ones which are a type of services which can interact with multiple applications. Okay, so let's take an example. Okay, so if you are having one application, like one web application and one of the mobile application, now if they want to interact with each other at the time, it will be very difficult for programmers, because there will be lot of errors on the both of sides. Okay, so they have to solve those errors from both of the application, then only they will be able to interact with each other. Okay, so now at the end of this particular process, there will be the package size will be very much big. Okay, their functionality will be very, very slow, and there will be too many errors. Okay, so this will be a huge headache for the developers. Okay, so to resolve this particular issue, they came up with APIs. So APIs are the ones which will be interacting with both of the things. Okay, they will also be interacting with the database servers, web servers. Okay, and they will be transmitting the data from one application to another, or they will be transmitting all the types of things within those APIs. Now, to understand it better, let's take one of the real world example. Okay, so we all will be using Facebook as a mobile application, right? Now, whenever you are opening that particular Facebook, at that time, Facebook will check your location, it will check your weather, it will, if you want to chat with your friends, it will allow you to chat with your friends via Messenger, right? So now, if all of these functionalities will be in that particular application at that time, the application size will be much more bigger. Okay, so and Facebook will first of all check one functionality for location. After that, it will go with that weather application functionality, and after that, it will be going to that particular Messenger functionality. So it will be it will be taking one process after another, right? So at that time, it will be slower. So now, what happens is that particular application will be, the size of application will be much more bigger, and that there will be lot of bugs in each of the functionality, right? So now what they will be doing is they will be taking one of the API call for each and every functionality. For example, for if they want to check the weather, they will call weather APIs. If they want to check the location, they will be calling the location APIs. Okay, and if you want to chat with your friends, they will be calling that particular Messenger APIs, right? So now, whenever you are opening your application, parallelly all the API calls will be started. Okay, and parallelly it will be getting executed. So once it gets response for one of the API, it will be shown to you. Okay, so here the benefit for that particular application will be it will just be getting integrated with those APIs. So here the packet size will be very much less. Okay, and all the APIs will be executed parallelly, so functionality will also be increased, and the time taking will also be decreased, and you will get the faster responses. And now when it comes to the bugs and the errors from the application, they just need to focus on the bugs which are related to API, not the full Facebook application. Right, so this is why the APIs are important nowadays. Now, our next thing will be why we want to secure those APIs. Right, so basically, we know that now, when it comes to APIs on the based of the business functionalities, APIs will be connected to some of the databases, it will be connected to web servers, okay, it will be connected to different of the applications, and it will be transmitting some of our data, right, on the based of the functionality of API. So now there might be some of the sensitive data that particular API will be transmitting. Okay, so if there is any misconfiguration or if there is any vulnerability, then it can affect the security of full organization. Okay, so if to understand it better, let's take an example of an organization overview. Okay, so basically there will be two types of application in particular organization. Okay, first one will be public facing applications, and second one will be internal applications. So public facing applications will be the one which will be web applications, mobile applications, API applications, right? And the internal applications will be the one, their operating systems, their internal softwares which they have downloaded. Okay, so their internal services. So now what happens that even if so basically The public facing applications are the one which will be connected to the internal servers and internal organization. So now if there are any misconfiguration in that, then attacker can make use of that particular application vulnerability and it can attack on that particular organization. Right. So now what happens that even if their web application is fully secured and their mobile application is fully secured, but there is vulnerability in their API, then also there might be some type of data leakage and there might be some type of injection which will help that particular attacker to gain access to their servers and ultimately attacking that particular organization. Okay, so this was the overview of APIs, that what are the APIs and what are why we need to secure it. Now when it comes to APIs, there are mainly two types of APIs. First one will be REST API and second one will be SOAP API. Okay, so basically these are the most used APIs. Now what happens that when it comes to REST APIs, right? So representational state transfer. Okay, so these are these are used for creating some web services, and they will be used to communicate between those two services or those two particular applications. Basically, they will be used for communicating for that particular applications. Now when it comes to SOAP APIs, it will be having the same functionality. Okay, but the main difference between them will be that REST APIs will be the one which will be using XML format, JSON format, HTTP format, URL format. Okay, so it will be using multiple standards, but when it comes to SOAP APIs, it will only be using HTTP and XML format. Okay, so basically from here we can understand that when it comes to the injection or when it comes to vulnerability testing, there will be two types. So basically when it comes to SOAP APIs, we can majorly check for XXC vulnerabilities. Okay, and after that when it comes to another type of injections and everything, we will be able to check in most of the vulnerabilities in REST APIs as well. Okay, so now when it comes to challenges, so basically whenever we are pen testing any of the web application or mobile application, right? So basically we were not facing that much challenges because those are really those are available in the public internet, right? So basically in the public sites, and we will be able to access it, we will be able to understand the functionality of that particular application, and we will be able to check that okay, these are the things which we need to test. But when it comes to APIs, we will be facing several challenges. Okay, so basically we cannot directly check those old things, or we cannot directly pen test directly to those particular APIs. Okay, so here our main three challenges will be: first, that in API it will not be having any GUI. Okay, so for any of the web application or mobile application, there were several GUIs, right? So basically we were able to see the pages, we were able to see the parameters, we were able to see those functionalities, that what is the main reason behind those pages. Okay, what is the main processing that is going in the background. Okay, so we were able to understand those functionalities, but here we will be just getting the request and response, and sometimes if the parameters are having those type of thing, so if the parameters are having known names, okay, so at that time sometimes we can understand what is the main functionality of that particular API call. Otherwise we will not be able to understand those also. Okay, so the first challenge which we'll be facing here will be it will not be having any type of GUI. Second one will be that we have to validate the request. Okay, so basically there will be two types of responses majorly. Either it is processed or it is rejected. Okay, so if there is any type of header missing or any value that is incorrect at that time, the server will not be processing, it will directly reject it. Okay, so 80% of our time we will get the response of 500 or 404 because our request is not perfect. Okay, so at that time, whenever everything is correct and everything is in place, at that time only we will be able to get the particular response where the server has processed our request. Okay, so in that case, there are very less chances where we can insert our payload and the server will be processing it. Okay, so it that will also be one particular challenge for us, because the server will be checking the full request, whether anything is missing or not, or whether it is expected request or not. The third thing will be that parameters and the scope will be very less compared to any of the other applications. Okay, so for example, if we take up any of the website, right? So there will be multiple pages, that there will be some of the sites which will be having almost 50 pages or almost 25, 30 pages, right? So there will be much more bigger scope. Each and every page will be having multiple parameters. We can check throughout that particular things, okay? Those type of things will be happening same way in the mobile application as well. But when it comes to APIs, there will be a very less API calls, okay? Sometimes there will be 3 to 4 API calls in one particular bounty program or one project, and the parameters will be almost 5 to 6 or at max 10 parameters from which we have to check through it, okay? So the scope also will be very less, okay? And so we will be getting very less scope and parameters where we can test it, when we can check whether it is correct or not. Okay, so these are the major challenges which we are facing. Anyways, we are going to see all those demos in the further lecture, in the further this particular webinar itself. Okay, but this will be a high level overview of it. Okay, now let's get to our next topic, that is what all tools and techniques we are going to use. Okay, so basically the main 3 tools which we are going to use is Burpsuit. Okay, second one is Postman tool for REST APIs, and third one is SOAP UI for the SOAP APIs. Okay, so now what happens that Burpsuit will be the one which we will be using for testing or as an interceptor. Okay, because we want to take up those requests, we want to test it in multiple times, we want to insert our payload, and we want to do the security testing of that particular APIs. Right, so that for that we will be using Burpsuit. But when it comes to the Postman and SOAP UI, we are using this because normally there will be multiple methods where that will be used in any of the API call. Okay, so if there is a post method or delete method, okay, so all those data will be going through the body, and those particular data will not be able to insert in browser or our Burpsuit. Okay, so at that time we will use post parameter, postman tool or SOAP UI so that we can insert all those headers and body. Okay, and then we will take up those particular requests to our Burpsuit and we will start testing those API calls. Okay, so this is why we will be using Postman tool and SOAP UI with the integration of Burpsuit. Okay, so we will have a high level overview from where you can download it from, how you can use it. Okay, so first of all, we will be using this particular Burpsuit. Okay, so here in this case, we will be using the community version. Okay, because normally there will be some people who will not be using the professional version of Burpsuit. Okay, so we will not be using the professional, we will be seeing the community version only, so that everyone can use it and everyone can check for the practicals as well. Okay, so here this is the one from where you can download it. Okay, I will share those old links within the chat window itself so that you can go ahead and you can download these old tools. Okay, so this is the first particular tool which we are going to use. The second one is Postman tool. So Postman tool, here you can go to this particular application, you can go to Windows application, you can download that particular Postman tool. So here this is the one from where you can download it. Okay, so similarly you can install the Postman tool for REST APIs. The third one is the SOAP UI. So basically SOAP UI we will be using for the SOAP APIs, but normally the latest version of both of the tools will be supporting both of the APIs. So normally we do not need any type of both the tools, but there are some cases where you can you will need the SOAP UI for the SOAP APIs. Okay, so basically we will not take a chance and we will install all those tools. Okay, so here is the place from where you can download the SOAP UI tool. Okay, and you can install it. For this particular webinar, I have already installed all of the tools. Okay, so that we do not waste time in the installation of tool. Instead, we can learn more practicals and we can see how we can check for the testing procedures. Okay, so this is that particular Burpsuit tool. I have already installed it. This is the Postman tool and this is the SOAP UI tool. Okay. So after installation, you will be getting this type of interfaces from which you can start testing your APIs. Now, how to integrate this both of the tools with our Burp Suite? Okay, so similarly, how we were integrating our Firefox with Burp Suite. Okay, similarly, we will be integrating those type of tools. Okay, so we will go to settings, and in settings we will go to proxy. And in proxy, we will be going to the custom proxy configuration. And in that, we will be going to we will be adding our local host and one of the port which is not already used by the system. Okay, so basically, if you are using any of the port which is already used by the system, the Burp Suite will not be able to take the request from there. Okay, so here for the demonstration, I have used 8063 port number. Okay, so basically, this is what we will be doing the configuration in our Postman tool. Here we will be closing it, and same things we will be giving in our Burp Suite for taking the request. So here we will go to a proxy. In proxy, we will go to options. In options, we will go to proxy listeners, and we will add one more listener. Okay, so here we will go to add, and we will add the same port which we have added in Postman tool. So here I will add 8063, which I have added in my Postman tool. Here we will be clicking on OK, and we will be going to that Postman tool, and we will be checking whether we are able to intercept it or not. So I will go to Burp Suite. I will make my intercept on. And I will be giving any of that particular request just to show you that whether we are getting those requests or not. So I will send that request, and we will see that whether we are getting the request or not. Okay, so here you can see we have gotten one request, and in user agent you can see that it is coming from the Postman runtime. Okay, so basically this is the request which is coming from the Postman tool. Similarly, whenever you are adding those all API calls in your Postman tool, you will be able to get it to that particular Burp Suite, and you will be able to start testing those API calls. Okay, how we are going to add and how we are going to check for the API calls, that we are going to learn in the next demonstration or in the further demonstration. Similarly, we will be going through the SOAP UI, and we will be taking up the proxy from there also. Okay, so we will go to file. Here we will go to preferences, and in preferences we will go to proxy. Here we will in host we will be adding our local host. Okay, and in the port we will be adding any other port which is not currently used by the system. Okay, so here I will be adding 8062. I will be clicking on OK. And same things, we will be going to add it in our Burp Suite as well. So in proxy listeners, I will be going and I will be adding 8062, and I will be clicking on OK, and I will be taking that particular request also. Okay, so this is how we will be checking, taking all the requests. We will be checking that how we will be creating our lab environment for testing of those APIs. Okay, so now we will be going through the next all things. Once we have created all the lab environment, now we will be going through the how to test, or what all are the vulnerabilities that we can test in APIs. Okay, so our main objective here will be I will explain you three of the vulnerabilities which we will be seeing majorly in APIs. Okay, and we will be checking that how to exploit it, and how to check that what are the ways for exploiting those old vulnerabilities. Okay, and at last we will be going through the bug bounty programs as well, and we will see that how can we find the vulnerabilities in bug bounty programs also. Okay, so now let's get back to our PPT, and we will see the vulnerabilities itself. Okay, so first, our first vulnerability will be OAuth related vulnerability. Okay, so basically how our learning flow will be going through. Okay, so first of all, we will be learning the OAuth vulnerabilities that will be somewhat easier vulnerabilities. Okay, so you can grab all, you can grasp all the things. After that, we will be going through the complex vulnerabilities, and we will be learning how to exploit those vulnerabilities as well. Okay, so the first vulnerability is OAuth related vulnerability. Okay, so before going to that particular vulnerability, let's understand that what is OAuth, why it is used, and how to check any misconfiguration in OAuth framework. Okay, so first of all, when it comes to OAuth, okay, so basically OAuth is a standard for authorization of services. Okay, so basically whenever you need to give your authorization to access specific services, at that time they will be using some OAuth framework, and they will be accessing the specific services from your system. Okay, so for example, let's take an example so that you can understand it better. So basically, there is a web application or any of the application where you can upload your pictures. Okay, so now you don't want to upload everything from your computer system or any everything from your system itself, because it will take lots of bandwidth, and it will be taking much more time also. Okay, so now there will be one option from which you have already uploaded everything in your Google Photos or in your Facebook or in your Twitter. Okay, so now you want them to take those pictures from that particular site itself. So here, for example, we will take up Facebook so that you can relate it, you can understand it, right? So now what happens that for getting access to your photos, okay, they will need your ID password, right? But for security reasons, we will not be giving them our ID password, correct? So now what we will be giving is we will be giving the specific access to our specific photos, which or any of the specific services which we want to give. Okay, and we will take away, they will take those old things which you have given authorization of, and they will be adding into their particular database or any in their particular services. Okay, so for that, they will be using the OAuth framework. They will be taking out all those accesses, and they will be getting the data from the Facebook itself. So now, first of before going through, we will be understanding the flow of OAuth. Okay, so first one will be that we will be acting as a user. The second one will be the application where we want to upload our photos, or where we want to log in with the Facebook, or where we want to sign up with the Facebook. Okay, so that will be that particular application. And the third party is the Facebook. So here Facebook is just as an example. Here there will be any of the thing. Okay, there might be Google Plus, Twitter, or anything that will be giving you functionality for using their OAuth. Now the first thing will be whenever you want to send anything, first of all, we will be creating one particular OAuth request. Okay, so there every of the information will be going that which is the login type, or from to where we are giving the OAuth type. Okay, so there will be first type like Facebook or Twitter or something will be there. Okay, so that is the first parameter which we will be sending in our OAuth request. Second one will be your client ID. So it will be generating a random client ID that will be used for you. Okay, so from that ID only they will be able to know that, okay, this is that particular person to whom they will be authenticating. The third one will be the redirection. Okay, so after successful authentication, whenever you are entering the Facebook ID password, after successful authentication, where you want that particular user to get redirected. So basically, there that particular site will be entering their particular URL on that site. Okay, so some site will be sending that particular user to their login pages, or they will be sending that user to some of their dashboard pages. Okay, so this all information will be going through in the first request. Okay, these all things will be going to Facebook. Once Facebook, and after that Facebook will be authenticating you. So you have to enter the ID passwords of Facebook. Okay, so that Facebook will understand, okay, this is the correct user, and then they will be giving the response. So in that case, if you are already logged into the Facebook, this particular step will not be needed. Okay, so that Facebook page, they will be giving you Facebook login page, and you have to enter those Facebook login credentials. Okay, if you are already logged in, Facebook will directly go jump to the next step, that is give that is asking for the token. So basically, the next step will be the user will ask for specific token after the successful authentication. So basically, once this particular request is coming to Facebook, Facebook will check whether this user is correct or not. It will generate one of the token, okay, one of the access token, and it will send back to you. Now, what happens is you will send that particular token to this particular site, and that site will be sending that token to Facebook. Facebook will cross verify that particular token is correct or not. Once it is correct, it will give the response in which your data will be there. So here in this case, if you are signing up with the Facebook, then Facebook will give your profile details, your likes, Facebook friends, or those type of things. If you want to take the photos, then they will be giving those whole details to that particular site. Okay, but the main thing is the access token. So here, in any case, if this particular access token is getting compromised, okay, so there might be chances where user can get exposed, or any attacker can take over the account of the user. Okay, so at last, what will happen is you will get those type of data. The site will get those type of data, and you will be able to do next procedures from that particular site. Okay, so this is the regular flow of Oath. Now, what happens is, first of all, we will understand the request. Okay, so whenever we have seen the first request that is going to the Facebook, right? So in that, they will be giving that particular Oath dialogue where they will be asking for specific credentials, or they will be asking for, they will be giving the specific three parameters from which Facebook will understand, okay, this is that particular person. So the first parameter will be login type. Okay, so here this particular login type is the one where it will mention that in which particular framework we are using. So basically, you are going with Oath of Google, or Oath of Facebook, or Oath of Twitter. Okay, it will be mentioning those type of details there. Next one will be client ID. So as we discussed, it will be a randomly generated client ID, and which will be cross verifying you as a user. Third one will be redirect URI. So this is the one where after successful authentication, or after successfully generating the token, say Facebook will send that particular token to redirect URI, and it will redirect the user to that particular URL which is sent to that particular with that particular request. Okay, so this is the particular this is that request for flow. Okay, that how the Oath will work in background. Now we will try to understand that how can we find the vulnerabilities in Oath framework. Right, so for that, the main thing will be that how much we have to check that how much secure is our token during this whole process. Okay, so it will be processing, it will be getting generated from the Facebook. We will be asking for that particular token. It will be giving the response. Okay, so in this case, how much secure is our access token during this flow. Okay, so if there is any compromise within this old request, then it will be a vulnerability in Oath framework. So there are multiple things from which we can test for the Oath framework. Okay, we can test for the Oath vulnerabilities. Okay, so there are multiple requests. We will be checking it in the future. Okay, so for now, we will be taking one of the example, and we will be testing it whether any site is, or any of the API call is vulnerable for it or not. So normally, the Oath is a type of API. So basically, they will be integrated with some of the applications, some of the mobile applications, web applications. Okay, so that's why it will be coming under this particular topic of API testing. Okay, so the first thing which we will be testing is the how to compromise, or how to steal those tokens with the use of Oath redirection. Okay, so first of all, before learning it, let's see how much critical this particular vulnerability is, and if you are giving it to some of the bug bounty programs, then how much you will be expecting on those particular things. Okay, so this is the first report which we are going to see. Okay, so same thing is OAuth redirection with the open redirection with the use of OAuth framework and stealing token with that. Okay, you can see the bounty of 500. Okay, and basically it is critical because normally after stealing the tokens, any attacker will be able to make use of those tokens and he will be able to take over your account if there is this type of misconfiguration or if this type of vulnerability is there. Okay, so just to give you a better scenario, I will be showing you one of the other reports so that you can understand it better and you can learn it in that particular case. Okay, so this is the same thing. You can see here stealing OAuth tokens with the redirect URI. Okay, and you can see this, but the bounty is 750. Okay, so basically this is how much critical it is. Okay, here you can see the severity also. Okay, so basically now we will understand that how to find this vulnerability and how to exploit it. Okay, so for that we will be taking one of the sites. So here for demonstration we will be taking multiple sites. Okay, but that will be just for educational purpose. Okay, we are not intending anything to harm those type of API calls or API sites or any type of applications. Okay, this will be just for educational purpose, and we are not happy if you are trying to exploit those old API calls or those type of sites. Okay, so here you can just learn it from here. Okay, and you can use it in any other bug bounty programs or any other programs so that it will you can help those programs to get better in their security. Okay, so here there is, so back to our demonstration. So here there is one particular option where we can sign up or log in with the Facebook. So here, just to show you, we have already logged into our Facebook so that we do not have to enter our ID password during the live webinar. Okay, so and it will not ask us anything because we are already authenticated in this particular browser. So normally it will not ask us those type of ID passwords. It will directly go ahead with the next step for asking for those tokens. Okay, so now we will take up this particular request and we will see that what all are the things that are going through that particular site. Okay, a particular request. So this is that particular request. Okay, so let me open it in the Notepad so that I can show it to you better. So now I think you are able to see this request, right? So basically the first thing is the login type. So as we discussed in login type, they will be mentioning which is the place where you are using those OAuth types. Okay, so here in this case, we are using Facebook as our OAuth framework, okay, for getting authentication and for getting those type of data. Second one is account ID or client ID. This will be randomly generated and you will be able to see those IDs, okay, and Facebook will be able to recognize you on the basis of those IDs. And third one will be redirect URI. So after successful authentication, the Facebook will be giving the token to this particular page, okay, and from that particular token, that site will be getting that those old details of your account, and they will be creating your account or getting those services which they want you or which you have authenticated. Okay, so this is that particular OAuth flow. Okay, so now how can we check the vulnerabilities for that? Okay, so let's get back to our request in Burp Suite. Okay, so basically this is the main parameter where you can check for the O3 direction vulnerability. So basically in every request, here it was Facebook, if you are going signing up with the Twitter, or if you are going to any of the auth for Google Plus or any of the auth framework, okay, the request will be same only. Okay, so but here parameters will be getting changed. So now we will try to get it. We will try to manipulate it. Here we will be adding any of our site. So here I will be adding bing.com. Okay, just to give you an example, just for the demonstration purpose, I will give bing.com. You can enter any of your site and we will forward that request. Okay, but before doing that, let me show you how that particular successful scenario looks like. Okay, so that you will be able to understand that how the vulnerable scenarios will be looking like. So I will just keep the same thing. Okay, so here the request which was coming from the browser itself, that is the same request. Okay, here that particular site is only coming. So now we will just forward that request and we will see what is the response that is coming to the site. So here in background, all the flow which I have explained you previously, that all things will be coming up, and you can see we will be going through the my account and that site will be authenticating you. Now let's get back to our vulnerable scenario after testing how it will look like. So now what we will do is we will take up that request, we will change those parameters. Okay, so I will go to login with Facebook. Similarly here I will add the bing.com. So instead of this I will add bing.com. I will remove this login users and all those things, and then I will forward that request. I will turn off my intercept and we will see what is happening and what is the response that we are getting. Okay, so here you can see that we are redirected to bing.com. That is one of the vulnerability, but at last you can see that we have also gotten one parameter called code, and in that we have the value of that particular auth token which is generated by the Facebook. Okay, so this might help those attackers to take over that particular accounts of the user without their permission also. Okay, so this is how we will check for the O3 direction. Just to give you a better example, we will try it in different site as well. Okay, so that it will be it, you will be able to understand it better. And you will be able to learn it in different sites as well. So here instead of this, I will just add some another site. So I will add it as a evil.com and we will see what is happening there. Okay, so I will just forward that request. I will make my intercept off and we will see what is the response coming from that particular site. Okay, so now you can see that here also it is evil.com where we are getting redirected, and at last you can see that this is the code which we are getting. Okay, so this is that particular code from which the attacker will be able to get that particular code, and you will be able to see that what is the code, and ultimately you will be able to take over those accounts. Now let's show you some of the secure scenarios so that you can understand it better in the better way. Okay, so that you will be able to check for your things also. Okay, so we will see how the secure scenario looks also. Okay, so that you can have a better understanding on this particular vulnerability and you can test it in your client sites or any of the bug bounty sites. Similarly here we will go to login with Facebook. Here we are already logged in the Facebook. Okay, so basically it will not ask us about our ID password of Facebook, but whenever you are not logged into that particular browser, you will have to enter your Facebook ID password and then it will authenticate you. Okay, so except that every functionality will be same itself in every site. Okay, so that you can check it. Okay, so you can first of all what we will be doing is we will make our intercept on and we will go to login with Facebook. Here we will forward all these requests. We will get the request which is using that particular auth and we will go to that. Okay, so here the same things are going. Okay, here you can see client ID, the redirect URI and the scope of that thing. So here in that particular parameter, we will go ahead and we will manipulate, we will try to manipulate that parameter, and we will see that how can we test for it. Okay, so here we will go through that particular site and we will enter our bing.com as a URL, and we will forward that request and we will turn off our intercept. So here you can see that URL is blocked because it was not coming under the whitelist of it was not whitelisted for the in the client auth settings. Okay, so if they are having this particular misconfiguration at that time, we will directly get redirected. We will be able to fetch those codes and tokens which are used for auth. Okay, but if we are if it is in whitelisted, then we will be getting this particular type of error, and ultimately we will not be able to get the code which can be used in malicious purpose. Okay, so this was how we will be exploiting the vulnerability, how we will be checking out how to steal the tokens, and how to exploit the auth vulnerability or auth redirection vulnerability. There are multiple auth redirection or auth vulnerabilities. Okay, there we can use auth CSRF for stealing the tokens. There is another thing for like code impersonation. Okay, so there are almost 10 vulnerabilities related to auth. Okay, but that all things we will be learning at the end of the sessions. Okay, currently we will be going with the flow and we will be understanding next all vulnerabilities so that you can have a better understanding in different vulnerabilities also. Okay, not just giving into one vulnerability only. So the next one is the sensitive data exposure. Okay, so basically sensitive data exposure are also the things where there will be any of the sensitive data which can get leaked, and that you can get all the types of you can misuse all those data, and you will be able to exploit that particular data in the further way. Okay, so there are main two things from which you can get the sensitive data. Okay, first one will be their GitHub page, and second one will be their pages or response or API calls, the response of this API calls. Okay, so here for just a demonstration, I will give you the first one. Okay, first example, and after that, if you are getting much more time, we will be going through the second vulnerability also, and we will be learning the sensitive data exposure of that also. Okay, but for this particular demonstration, I will be giving you the first method or first trick from which you can get the sensitive data of that particular site. Now, here what happens, first of all we will understand what is sensitive data before going forward with this particular vulnerability. Okay, so basically the first thing for this particular sensitive data is what are sensitive data. So, okay, so sensitive data are the ones like API keys. Okay, just focusing on the API pen testing, so here the sensitive data will be API keys, because normally API keys are the one from which API the users will be getting authenticated, or any services will be getting authenticated. Okay, so normally with every request, those API keys will be going through several headers or any of the parameters in post, and normally from that server will cross verify whether that particular thing, a particular token or API key is correct or not, and on the basis of that it will be giving you the response. So the first thing that is for APIs that is sensitive is API keys. After that, any passwords are there, user IDs are there, email IDs, PII information, all those things will come in sensitive data. Okay, so if anything, any one of the it is getting leaked, at that time we can tell it as a vulnerability. Okay, so now we will see how can we test for it. Okay, so before going through that, we will understand that we will go through one of the HackerOne reports so that you can understand it better. Okay, and you can see that how much critical it is. So we will go back to our browser and we will just take up one of the reports so that you can understand it better. So here you can see the severity. Okay, it is 7 to 8 to 8.9. Okay, it is pretty much high, and you can see that the bounty for this particular thing is 1000. Now, how can we test for it? Okay, so basically, we will directly jump to GitHub and we will focus on any type of sensitive data. Okay, so the first thing for going through it, we will open up GitHub and we will try to search for it. So now, we cannot search directly like we are searching in Google, give me the password or anything, right? So basically, we will use several keywords and we will test for it. Okay, so basically, we will use several keywords. We will check whether anywhere that type of things are getting leaked or not. If it is getting leaked, you can directly prepare your report and you can directly share it with the bug bounty program or any type of your clients. Okay, so first of all, how to set up your keywords. Okay, so first, the first thing that you can see is we will use the inverted commas. Okay, so in which, first of all, we will be mentioning the organization which we are testing, okay, either your clients or any bug bounty programs. And after that, we will be focusing on the keyword which we want to search for that particular parameter. So here in this case, I will use API key. Okay, so API hyphen key will be my keyword for this particular thing. Here, instead of API key, if you want to search for any password, you can add those, you can use password or you can use user ID, any PII information, those type of things, you can search for it. Now, in the first one, we will be entering our organization. So here, just for the demonstration, I will use New York Times so that you can and so that we can see whether anything is getting leaked or not. Okay, but in that particular phase, you can test it in any of other sites so that you can test in your time, in your client sites or in your bug bounty programs as well. So here I have used NY Times, I have used API key, and here we will go to code. So whenever we are getting the result, here you can see there is one API for New York Times, and at last you can see the API key parameter and the API key of that particular API. Okay, so similarly here, one of the API key is getting leaked. Similarly, in all the results, if there is any leakage, it will be showing you this type of leakage. Okay, if it is leaked, you will be seeing full API key. Okay, so this is the insecure scenario. Now, if it is secure scenario, they will be using this type of functions where they will be using some of the API key which is not in the readable format or which is not the particular, and they will be calling in that particular variable for giving that particular API key. Okay, so this is the secure scenario. If that is getting leaked, it will be showing like this. Okay, so similarly, directly from this result itself, you can check for it. You can see whether it is working or not. And on the basis of that, you can use this particular thing for the bug bounty programs or any of your client organization or in itself. Okay, so this is how we will check for the sensitive data exposure. Here we will be, if you are getting further time in our webinar itself, I will be showing you this, except that if you are not getting time, we will be showing you in our sessions itself. Okay, now let's get back to our complex vulnerability. So the first vulnerability for Oath will be Oath was some type of easy vulnerability. Okay, after that we have seen one of the medium vulnerability. Now let's go ahead with the complex vulnerability, which are hard to find. Okay, and which are the very critical vulnerabilities from that we can have so many of that particular services. We can access those services of that server, or we can see the internal things of that particular server. Okay, so let's go to our high critical vulnerabilities, and we will see that how can we check for it. Okay, so the first thing will be SSRF. Okay, so normally before learning how to exploit the SSRF, first of all, let's learn that what is SSRF. Okay, so basically, whenever there is a functionality of the server, where server will be processing our URLs. Okay, so if there is any functionality like the server will be taking that URL, server will be fetching those images from that particular URL, and it is transforming that image from PNG to or something, or that thumbnail to, from that image to thumbnail. Okay, so those are the functionalities, or any of the image to PDF. Okay, so basically the main functionality here is it will be fetching some of the data from some of the URLs and it will be processing it. So if you are finding this type of parameters, so normally Here, these all parameters will be having major functionalities where we can misconfigure, where we can see, we can find the vulnerabilities, and we can check for whether we can use this parameter to exploit multiple things from that server itself. Okay, so basically here, if the functionality is just to store that particular URL, then it should just store that. It should not process it. Correct. If that particular functionality is just to take that particular image, then it should just take it. It should not process it, right? So normally, if it is doing more processing in that case, if it is not doing the functionality which it is making for, or if they are not having specific things, specific configurations from which we cannot go to, we can go to their internal server. So at that time, we will be able to say that that is our successful SSRF. Okay. So now there are two main ways from which we can check for the SSRFs. Okay. First we will understand what all are the impact for it. So normally the impact for SSRF will be, first and main thing will be, we will be able to scan that particular internal IP addresses. Okay. So if normally whenever we are scanning that server, okay, from the outside of the network, at that time there will be a firewall which will be blocking our several requests, right? So we will not be able to exactly know that whether there is whether all the ports there are open or not, okay, which all are the exact ports which are open or not. So those all things we will not be able to understand in the first phase itself, right? So there will be so many ports which will be blocked by the firewall itself, and we will not be able to exactly get whether those are closed or those are blocked by the firewall. So that is the first impact. Second impact will be, we can send the request to outward of servers. Okay, so basically if there is any third party server, I want to attack those servers. So at that time I can make use of this particular server. I can use it as a proxy and I can attack on the third party server. So in the third party servers, my IP address will not be shown. Okay, so everything will be shown of this particular server which is vulnerable to SSRF. The third one will be, we can read internal resources, we can use internal services, okay, which we are going to see in a bit, but we will be able to use or execute the services which as a user we should not use it. Okay, so these are the main critical impact for this particular SSRF. Okay, so now basically it is a critical vulnerability. Normally the bounties will be varying from $1,000 to $3,500, and you can check for it. Now let's get to see that how it will be working. Okay, so basically here for checking the SSRF, what all things are, whenever we are getting any API call, what all things we need to look for. Okay, so the main thing which we need to look for is the parameters which are accepting the URLs. Okay, any parameter which are accepting the URLs will be the one where you can test for SSRF. Okay, so let's get back to the practicals. We will see how can we test for it. Okay. So basically this is that particular API call which we are going to use. We are going to see the practicals in this particular API call. Okay, so normally the background functionality is, it will take up the URL, it will fetch that particular site, it will take a screenshot and it will show it to us. Okay, so normally it can be used as a thumbnail for checking those type of things. Okay, so this is the background of the functionality of this API call. Now what happens is, it is going to that particular site. Okay, it is going to that particular site, it is processing it, and it is showing us the result, right? So this is the work of this particular API call. Now we will see one of the simple site so that you can understand what is the background functionality of this. Okay, here I will just add bing.com and we will see what is coming up. So basically it has gone to bing.com, it has taken that particular screenshot, it has shown the screenshot to us. So this is the normal functionality. Now what we will be doing is we will try to access those internal IP addresses. We will try to see whether we are able to access those type of things or internal ports or not, whether we are able to exactly see that which old ports are open and which old ports are not open. So for it, I will add the local IP address. Okay, so that will be 127.0.0.1, and I will add the port 1. Okay, because normally we want to see whether it is open or not. So I will just enter that thing and we will see what is the response coming up. So here you can see the site can't be reached, means like we are getting this particular response. Now here you can see that that particular site is in the HTTP format, right? So normally it will be running on 80 port. So at that particular port will be open, right? So now we will see one of the port that is open. So here we will enter 80 port and we will see what is response coming there. So here you can see that access denied means the first port where we were getting that type of response was closed, and 80 port where we are getting this type of response is open. This is how we will check for, we can enumerate all the ports from 1 to 65,535. Okay, and we can exactly tell that, okay, these all are the ports which are open, these all are the ports which are closed. Okay, and here firewall will not be an obstacle for us, so we can exactly tell what is the correct thing that is there. Okay, after getting all those responses, if any attacker is there, he will be able to point it out to that particular ports and he will be able to bypass those firewalls and those type of things he can do, right? So this was the impact where we can see the internal things. Now if we want to see whether this particular vulnerability we can make use of it and we can check for the request to outward servers or not. Okay, so for that you can make up your own server in your system. Okay, and you can add that particular IP address, you can execute that particular request and you can see whether you are getting those responses or not. Okay, that will be the one way. Second way will be if you are using Burp Suite Professional, here there will be one option called Burp Collaborator Client. It will be the same thing where that particular in your system Burp will create one of the server. It will be giving you one of the URL. You can enter those URLs here and you can see whether any type of request is coming up or not. If that request is coming up, that is also one type of vulnerability in SSRF where you can request to outward servers. Okay, but after that you have to find the impact of it. Okay, whether what all things else you can do with that particular vulnerability. Okay, so now this was the two of the cases which you can test for SSRF. Okay, and this was the practicals where we will be seeing that whether it is working or not. Now let's get back to the advanced thing. Okay, so the third thing which I have, the impact which we have understood was the using the service of that particular server if they are vulnerable with SSRF. Okay, so we will see the same thing and we will try to execute the same thing. Okay, here, but there is a catch. So we will check for the things which are already vulnerable. Okay, and we will see that whether it is working for that or not. Okay, so here we will take up one of the HackerOne report. Okay, and we will see what is happening there, whether it is vulnerable or not. Okay, so those type of things we will be seeing. So basically here in this particular report, okay, it is already closed. Okay, so they have already mitigated that vulnerability. If you see the severity, it is 8.6. Okay, and it is on this particular site. Okay, where the bug bounty hunter was able to use SSRF to access their internal SMTP server to send spam mails from that particular server to another persons also. Okay, so he was able to use their internal server and he was able to send the spam mails from that particular server to any of the email IDs. Now if you go to that particular report here, all the things which we have already checked, okay, 127.0.0.1 and everything is already mitigated. Okay, so they have already tested for it. It is already already mitigated. So now what we will do is we will try to find the vulnerability, or we will try to bypass this mitigation and we will try to again find the vulnerability in the same case itself. Okay, so let's get back to that particular API call where the user was, or where that particular bug bounty hunter was able to find the access. So here, if I am using just 127.0.0.1, so it will be giving me this particular error, right? So in this case, what we it is already mitigated, and it is 2 years from there which they have mitigated. So normally they will now, till now they will be much more secure. Okay, here it is in 2018. So basically after 2 years they will be much more secure. They have they have or they might have old so added the remediations for so many times, and it will be much more secure compared to the first time itself. So now we will try to bypass it, and we will see whether we are able to get in the already mitigated mitigated API call. Okay, so here I am we have prepared one of the bypass cases. Okay, so we have taken it from, we have checked it, and we have already checked how to bypass it. Okay, so basically first of all we will understand that how this particular payload will be getting work. Okay, so first of all it will go to that for this particular site where we will be trying to use SSRF with the SMTP. Okay, so here the protocol which they are using is Gopher. Okay, so you can check for it. After that, we will enter the IP address as 0 and port 825, because normally they are using SMTP with the 25 port. And here in the domain, you can enter any of the domain for that particular site. Okay, so here anything like xyz at the red hacker one dot hacker target dot com, and here you can enter to whom you can enter those that particular email ID, and at last you can get enter that particular code. So here what we will be doing is we will take up this particular payload. Okay, you can find the same thing in GitHub as well. Okay, but here you can see how it is working. Okay, so basically we will execute this particular payload, and we will see what is the response that is coming from that particular server. Okay, so here you can see that we have bypassed that security which is already mitigated from 2 years back, and you can see all the details for that particular API call. Here they are using an vulnerable. Okay, so basically this is how we will check for it. We will try to bypass it, and we will enter that whether it is whether this type of things is vulnerable or not. So same things we are going to learn in our course as well. Okay, same thing we are going to learn. We are going to learn each and every vulnerability in depth. Okay, I will be showing you our full syllabus in bit. Okay, but before that, let's go further and let's explore more things out of this particular session. Okay, so now what happens is, now basically you have understood that how to get started with that particular bug bounties, how to search for specific vulnerabilities, how to exploit those vulnerabilities, how to see whether that is exploitable or not, how to check for remediations, okay, how to bypass if it is already remediated. Okay, so these all things we have already seen in this particular webinar. Now basically, whenever we were getting introduced with our APIs, right? So first of all, we have discussed it that if your API request is not correct, or if there is anything missing in your API request, you will not be able to get the particular response. Okay, so basically, it is not like web applications or mobile applications where you can install it, you can directly run it. Okay, basically here we need to configure those all API calls, and then we can start up with our bug bounties. So basically, first of all, here we will learn that how to get started whenever we are getting any type of API calls, and we can see that how to get started with those API calls, and so that you can also start your bug bounties with those API calls. Okay, so basically we have already seen one of the program from HackerOne. So now we will go ahead with the bug crowd, and we will take up two particular bug bounty programs. Okay, and I will show you how to get started with it. Okay, so for that we will be using a Postman tool, and we will be taking up in the perp suite, we will be checking how to use for it. Okay, so let's go up to the bug crowd, and let's go up to programs, and let's check what all are the things that are coming up. So here I will just close all the things with that we have already checked up. Okay, and we will go up to the programs. I will search for APIs. we will select two of the programs. Okay, first one will be Cloudinary, and we will see second program also so that you can have a better understanding on it. Okay, and the second one which we are going to see is from the last. Okay, one we have taken from the first, second one we will be taking from last, and we will be taking up both of the programs, and we will be seeing. So basically here, whenever you are seeing some of the website, right, you will be able to see that, okay, this is this particular website, this is the thing which you can these are the functionalities of this website, and you will be able to start testing it. Listen, that thing is not applicable for APIs, because normally APIs are the ones where you will not be able to understand the functionalities of APIs. So normally whenever anyone is giving you APIs for testing, they will be giving you some type of documentation. Either it will be your client side or any of the API bug bounty programs. Okay, so basically they will be giving you API documentation which will explain that these are the things which are going through those APIs, and in that case basically you will be able to understand each and every functionality of that particular API, and you will be able to get what all are the parameters that are enabled in APIs. Okay, so that you can have a better scenario for how to look up for that particular API or how to test that API. So here when you go to InScope, so here you can see there are two APIs. Okay, so there are two API calls which will be used. So now if you are opening both of the API calls, I will be opening both of the API calls. Let's see what is the result that is coming. Okay, so here you can see that is 4034 be done. If you go to second, it is not at all loading as well. Okay, so basically this is the response which you will be getting if you are not having any specific headers or any specific parameters for that particular APIs. So now what can we do for it? Okay, first of all, we will go to documentation, we will understand how to configure it, and then only we will be able to get the perfect response where server is processing our API request. Okay, so we will go to documentation. Everywhere you will find the documentation, either it can be in bug bounty programs or anywhere of your client side. Okay, you will be having those API documentation in hand so that you can understand those API calls, and ultimately you can test those API calls. So here we will go to API references. Here we will go to so these all are the API calls for that particular site. Okay, and here we will directly go to admin APIs because that is the interesting thing which we want to test it, correct? So now what we will do is, first of all, we will understand. So here they have already implemented rate limiting. Okay, they have already given those type of informations. Okay, so let's get back to authentication. So here API uses basic authentication over HTTP. And what all things you will need is API key and API secret. Okay, so these are the three parameters which you will be needing for any API to work. Okay, so for any API of this program to work. Okay, so basically API key is the one thing, API secret is the second thing, and your cloud name is the third thing. So here from where we can find all those details. Okay, so here you can see that there is the dashboard page in their Cloudinary console. So we will go back to that particular program, we will search for Cloudinary console. So this is the one where we might find those type of things. So here you can go to console, you can go to Cloudinary. Okay, so basically we will log into that site. So you can create your own particular account. Here I have already created so that we do not waste time in creating the account, and those time we can save it for our demonstration also. Okay, so here we are getting three four four basic account details. Okay, first one is the cloud name, second one is API key, third one is API secret, and fourth one is environment variable. Okay, so we will note it down everything. We will note down in our notepad, okay, so that it will be helpful for us in future API testing for this particular program also. Okay, so I will just add those things. Okay, so we have all the details which we need, right? So now how can we make use of it? So basically we will go back to our API documentation. We will see how to add it in our Postman tool. So here they have given us one of the API call from which we can authenticate ourselves into that API call, and we can use the same things in that particular in the other API calls also. Okay, so here this is the call statement. So wherever you are finding the call statements, okay, those are the API calls which we can import it to our Postman tool. There are different ways to import other API calls that we will be learning in a bit. Okay, but here in this case we are having the call statement. So we will go to our Postman tool, we will go to import, and here in import we will have one option called paste raw text. We will go there, we will enter our API call. So now this thing will not work because we have not added our details, right? So if you see here, you can see that error in making in that particular function. So basically we have to add our details in that so that it will start working. Okay, we can use those API calls. So here you can see that here there is one option for API key. So we will insert our API key instead of that. Okay, so here we will add our API key. So this is our API key. We will take it, we will paste it. Here the second thing that this particular API call needs is API secret. Okay. So we will go to API secret. We will paste our API secret there. Next one is our cloud name. So this is our cloud name. We will paste our cloud name in this particular field. Okay. So now everything is ready. Now it is ready to get imported and it is ready to get used. So we will just go to import, and everything is imported. If you see the headers, all the headers are already set from the Postman tool itself. Now let's check the same thing in our verb suit, and we will see that whether it is getting us the proper response or not. So here we will send this particular request. We have already turned on the verb suit, and we will take up that particular request. Okay, so now this user agent is from Postman, so it is clear to us that this request is coming from the Postman tool, and this is the same request which we have initiated in our Postman tool. We will send it to repeater just to see the response from that. So here in the response we will send that thing, and we will see the response whether it is working or not. Okay, so here we are getting 200. Okay, so now the next thing that you can take is, so once we know that, okay, here we are getting the 200, okay, means the server is processing it. Now you can test all of the vulnerabilities, any of the injection which you want to test, and all those things you can test it in those particular API calls which are mentioned in the documentation. Okay, you can authenticate yourselves with the use of those type of parameters, and you can start testing on those API calls, which the vulnerabilities which we have already tested, all the vulnerabilities which we are going to learn in the future syllabus itself. Okay, so this is the first thing, that how to start up with your bug bounty programs. I will show one another case also from the which you can understand whether it is working or not. Okay, so let's jump to next bug bounty program. Okay, so this is the second bug bounty program which we are going to see. So similarly, you can see what all are in the scope. So basically here there is one API call which is in the scope. If you are trying the same thing, okay, if you are opening it, definitely we are not going to see the response like web application or mobile application here, okay, because these are the APIs. It will not be working in the front end. Okay, every time the APIs will be working in the back end, we will be able to see just the request and response of it. Okay, it will be going to take a loading, and ultimately our result will be either forbidden or 404 error or some type of errors we will be able to get, because normally this there are no parameters which we can test it directly, right? So now we will go to the documentation. So here you can see it is not directly written, so every time it will not be directly written that this is our documentation. Okay, there will be some cases where you will be finding the documentation but in the different name. So here you can see it is as a libraries, so but they have given the link. We will directly open that link and we will see whether it is what all are the information for that particular API calls. So here, just to save our bandwidth, I will just close, because anyways it is not going to give us the proper result as well. Okay, we will just go to our docs, documentations. Okay, I have turned on the intercept, that's why it was not working. Just to show you, let's take up that particular API call and you can see what is the response coming up. Okay, you can see that it is 404 page not found, right? Even if it is correct API, but then also it is showing those type of things. Let's go up to our documentation. We will learn both how to authenticate us, how to check up, how to take those API calls, and how to make use of it. So here, there is one option called config API, and we will directly go to configuration, and we will see what all are the things which we need for the configuration. So here you can see they will be using access token for authenticating that particular API call. Okay, so now how can we make use of it? So basically for that usage, you can use all this particular API call, and it will be using that particular API token, and you will be able to use that all the API calls from this particular API program. Now how can we get that token? So here you can see, as a workspace owner, you can create the access tokens in the access management page. Okay, in admin settings. So in their web application, there might be one of the option where we can create those tokens. So basically we will go to their application, we will open it in new tab. Okay, and here just to save our time, I have already logged into the application. Okay, so that you can directly go to that particular demonstration itself. Okay, we will not be wasting our time in creating the account and those type of small things. Okay, that you can do by yourself itself. So here we will go to the settings, and we will go back to our documentation. Where is it? Okay, you can see that access management page we want to go. We will go to settings, we will go to access management page. And here you can see one thing called tokens, and then we can go to create token. Okay, so basically before that, let us delete our previous tokens, and let us create one new token for the demonstration. So here I will just delete my previous token from my previous demonstration in the class. Okay, so here I will go to create token. Okay, we will make it as a owner token. Okay, so basically this will be having all the functionalities for which any admins or a workspace owner will be having. Okay, so I will make it as the name as a owner. Okay, and we will see whether it is working or not. Let's create any of the token we just have at this particular demonstration, right? So basically I will add any admin just to create the token and just to show it to you. Okay. Okay, we will go to create. Okay, and you can see we have one of the token which is coming for us. So basically what we will be doing is we will copy this particular token, we will note it down in our notepad so that we can make use of it in our API calls. Okay, now let's get back to our API documentation. Here we will go to references so that we can have the list of API calls which we can use it for testing. Okay, here we will go to run in Postman. Okay, so there might be some of the cases where they will give all of their API calls and you will be able to it. Definitely this will not be working in each and every API program. Okay, they will be giving different ways from which you can test for it. So basically you have to go through the documentation, you have to check for it. So here you can see there is one more thing, one particular collection is added. If you go there is 51 API calls which you need to, you can test it. Okay, so basically we can go to our API documentation, we can make use of that particular thing, and after that we will try to check for it. So basically we will go back, we will use this particular token, we will use this particular API call, and after that we have imported those all API calls, we will be testing it. So we will take this particular API call, we will import it. Okay, so now you all know that how to import it, right? Because we have seen it in our previous demonstration itself. We will go to paste raw text, we will enter that thing, and instead of this access token we will add our access token. Okay, so basically here we will go to our notepad, we will take up that particular token, we will add that particular token, we will import it. Okay, it is getting imported, and here if you go to headers, there came one of the header where our token is there. Again, we will just take up that particular request, we will see whether it is working or not. Here we will add up that particular request, we will take those requests in our burp suite. Okay, so this is the one, we will send it to repeater, and in repeater we will send those requests. And you can see that we are getting 200 response, and here you can test out all those things. Now if you want to use the same token in other API calls, how can we check for it? Because normally without that particular API token, okay, we will not be able to use it. So let me show you one of the example, okay, where without that particular token whether we are able to use it or not. Okay, so we will just use one of the API call, we will take up the same thing in our burp suite, and we will see what is the response we are getting it. Okay, here we will do send, we will take up that particular API call. So these all are the garbage things. Okay, we will not be able to see. Okay, here this is that particular request, we will send it to repeater, and we will send that request, and we will see what is the response coming. You can see authentication error, malformed, and this is expired, and we are not able to give you the proper response. Okay, so this is what you will get in normal API calls if you are going to request it. Now how can we use that particular token in all of the API requests of that particular program? Okay, here you can go to authorization, you can go to bearer token, because normally here they are using bearer token, that's why we are taking up as a bearer token. Okay, otherwise normally APIs are the one which will be using different methods for authenticating. They will be using some type of tokens, they will be using authorization header, they will be using XAPI key header. Okay, so it will be different from programs to programs. Everything you will be able to understand from the documentation itself. So before starting the testing, you have to go in depth in the documentation, and you have to see that whether it is working or not. So similarly here you can see that they are using bearer authorization. So here you can go to the type, you can select bearer token, and it will be auto populated. Our token will be auto populated because we have used it one time. Okay, now what we will do is we will try to take up in the burp suite, and we will see what is the response coming up there. Okay, So here you can see this is not that thing. This is that particular thing. We will send it to repeater and we will see what is the response. Okay, so basically if you see both of them are same things, same request, and if we send that request, you can see that we are able to get 200 response. Okay, similarly you can take up out of this 51 API calls, you can take up any of that particular thing. You can set up your authorization bearer token. You can send that thing and you will be able to get the perfect response from that particular API call. Okay, so this is how we will be starting up with that with the pen testing of APIs. Okay, so this is not the everything which we have seen. So normally this is the webinar and we are having the time for only 2 hours. Okay, so basically we will not be able to cover full thing. Okay, so how you can cover all the full thing? You can go up to our site. You can request for us for your training and we will be able to explain you everything. Okay, so just before that, let's go up to the conclusion. We will see what all things we have learned. Okay, so the first thing that we have learned is the overview of APIs. Okay, so that what are the APIs, what all things are there for APIs. Okay, what is how, why we need to secure those APIs. After that, we have gone through several tools and techniques for which we will be testing. Okay, we have gone through three particular API vulnerabilities. One will be auth vulnerabilities, second one will be the sensitive data exposure, third one will be SSRF. Okay, and we have also seen that how whenever it is a secure, it is already secure, how to bypass it in the bug bounty programs. Okay, so a similar thing we will be training you in the similar way in the classes also. Okay, so basically we will be training you full things in our programs also. Okay, basically in our programs what all things we are going to learn. Okay, so let's take up that thing and let's check up what all things you will be learning during whenever you are taking the syllabus itself. Okay, so this is the thing where you can go up to the our site. You can go to the training section. Okay, you will be finding all the trainings which we are providing. Okay, so here let's this is the webinar for API testing. So let's go up to our API testing course. Okay, we will be seeing our syllabus for API testing. Okay, so this is the page where you can see our syllabus. So here there is PDF section. You can go through that PDF section. Okay, so this is our syllabus for API testing. So basically you can see, get all the details from that. Okay, you can call us into this particular number for the demonstration itself. Okay, and personally our trainers will be coming up. They will be giving you personal demonstration on basically all the vulnerabilities, and they will be giving you high level of overview for that particular number. Okay, that particular training program. So let's take an overview of what all things you are going to learn during the syllabus itself. Okay, so the first thing that we are going to learn is the overview of API testing. Okay, so basically what all things we are, what all are the real life challenges, what all are the tools and frameworks. So the thing which we have seen in this webinar is a part of it. Okay, it is not the full thing that we are going to learn. There will be a much more thing in our live sessions. Okay, after that we will be going through the governance of it. So here basically if your client or anyone is there, if your client is using or they are developing those APIs, okay, so at that time basically as a pen tester we can suggest them to go under some type of governance so that they can go under the compliance, they can use those compliance and ultimately they can secure themselves. Okay, so we will be learning in depth about the governance, that how you can help your clients or any of your customers to undergo that particular governance and they can secure those API calls from the development phase itself. Second thing will be, we will be creating our lab environment. Okay, so basically we will be taking up several tools for different purposes. Okay, so there will be some type where we will be setting up our lab we will be taking up our lab, and we will be using several tools for reconnaissance. We will be using several tools for the frameworks. Okay, basically we will be taking up each and every one of it. We will be installing those old tools and we will be learning everything. After that, the third one will be API documentation. So here we have seen the part of documentation of two of the bug bounty programs. Okay, but when it comes to documentation, every minute detail will be available in those documentation. Okay, so there are several cases where we will be directly able to find the vulnerabilities from the documentation itself, okay, just by executing it. So we will be learning in depth that how to go through the documentation and how to learn those vulnerabilities, or how to find those vulnerabilities just by documentation without any execution of those programs. After that, we will be going through the security checklist. Okay, so basically checklists are the step-by-step procedures where we can use it and we can successfully complete your project. Okay, so those all are the things which you can get through it. So we will be going through a checklist for all of the things, okay, bug bounty hunters, pen testers, and all the pen testers and developers. Okay, after that we will be understanding that what is the difference between the web APIs, mobile APIs, and how can we check for the different scenarios in that cases. Okay, so basically when it comes to web APIs, we will be trying some of the vulnerabilities for XSS. Whenever those APIs are getting deflected in that particular web application, we can make use of a vulnerability of API. We can try to use those vulnerabilities in web application itself. Okay, similarly for mobile APIs, and how to check for those old vulnerabilities. After that, we will be going through a bit of reconnaissance. Okay, we will be searching for hidden parameters. We'll be searching for leakage of the API calls. We'll be searching for leakage of those type of sensitive data. So, okay, everything we'll be searching for, and completing up with our details. After that, we will be focusing on the authentication and authorization issues. So this is the major part where you will be finding major vulnerabilities in APIs, like sensitive data exposure. Okay, you can find it here. IDOR. We will be able to see those things. Okay, we will be able to see the functionality of other users. We will be able to execute the functionality of other users. You can take over the accounts of other users by getting the access control vulnerabilities. Okay, so this is what we are going to learn in the fourth module. After that, we will be focusing on all these issues like XSE, parameter pollution, SQL injection, RCE, manipulating this logic. Okay, so all those vulnerabilities we'll be going to see. And after that, we'll be focusing on the OWASP. Okay, so normally OWASP is the one which is released in 2019, okay, late 2019, okay, so still it is new. So basically in that case, we will be learning each and every topic of OWASP, and we will be seeing whether it is working or not. And after that, we will be focusing on the practicals of the other vulnerabilities, modern vulnerabilities, LFI, RFI, input validation, open redirection. Those all things we'll be going to learn. And everything we are going to make use of in practicals, okay, you can go to our site, you can check up all the details of the course, okay, and you can learn the things. Except that we are having different programs. You can go if you are interested in any other pair program related to bug bounty, or if it is helpful for you in your career itself as a consultant or as a penetration tester. You can go through other trainings also. You can learn those old things like malware analysis, thick blind pen testing, source code review. Everything is available in your plate. Okay, you can take up everything, anything, and you can learn it in this particular time. Okay, because now you will be having the more time for learning. You can make use of it in learning in the better ways. Okay, with the better organization, and you can make use of it. Now let's go up to our chat window. Okay, let's check what all are your doubts, and let's solve all of your doubts, and so that we will be able to help you with your queries also. Okay, so I will go through one by one in the chat window. Okay, you will and we will be solving those all things. So first one is informative webinar, it was good, but it was a bit fast. You can yeah. So normally this we were having just 2 hours of time for this particular webinar, and I want to make use of it so that you can learn most of the things from me. Okay, so that you can make use of it, and you can have a better understanding on it. So that's why it was a bit fast. But when it comes to the seminars, we will be taking it up. We will be making it slow, and until and unless that is not clear to you, we are not going to go through the second, or we are not going to go through the next vulnerabilities. Okay, so we will go to second thing, Celia. Okay, so how is it important to your career? Okay, so basically for the first thing, there are two things which will be helpful for you. Okay, so let's get it straight. The first one will be for bug bounty. So normally when it comes to APIs, so normally APIs are the ones which will be a public facing. So normally there will be bug bounty programs which you can test, you can have a better knowledge on those with the use of bug bounty programs. That will be one part of your career. Second thing will be, you can normally, if you are working as a penetration tester, you can take up the projects of API testing, and it will be helpful for you for successfully completing those API projects or API pen testing also. Okay, so in both ways you will be having the profit itself. Okay, you can make use of those knowledge in your company and your personal bug bounty programs. Okay, from Elisa, do you have? Okay, so yeah, we are having multiple training programs. You can see it in our training section in our site itself. Okay, so we are in bug bounties. We have starting with the web application bug bounties. After that, there is Android bug bounties, iOS bug bounties, API bug bounties. We are even going forward with the IoT bug bounties also. Okay, so you can take up anything, you can make use of it, and you can learn those old things. Okay, so you can go through all of this syllabus. Okay, and after that, you can. make use of it. Okay, next one is from Nisha. What are the procedures? Okay, so the procedures is simple. You can go to the schedules. You can request for the schedule for that particular a program which you are interested in. Okay, so here if you are interested in API bug bounty program, you can go to join demo. You can fill up your details. Okay, you will be getting a particular form where you can fill up your details. You can add up everything. Okay, but make sure if you will be entering all the correct details, so that our trainer or our management team will be able to contact you. And after that, we will be giving you a specific demonstration on those old things, and you can take up those course. Okay, so that will be one of the procedures. After that, if you can complete those old procedures, and you can successfully join our training sessions. Okay. and I will be the instructor. Okay, there are multiple instructor X as well. Okay, so you will be allocated to one of the instructor, and you will be starting your sessions. Next one is from Vivek. So what are the skills required to join? So basically there are no skills, okay, which are required to join, because we will be taking up from the scratch itself, and you from the webinar you have seen how much advanced we can go. All right, so from the scratch itself, we will be starting with the scratch, that what is that particular technology, from where we are starting, that all things until the bypass of firewall, bypassing filters, those all things we are going to learn, and we will be checking how to get started with those type of things. So basically you do not need any type of knowledge prerequisite. Okay, that there is nothing prerequisite for this particular course or any of the courses which we are training. Okay, but it will be better if you are having a bit knowledge on web applications or something, then it will be better. Otherwise we are going to teach you from the scratch itself. Okay, so nothing like we will be going from the scratch itself. So there is nothing which you have to take up. Okay, next one is Devin. from the company production. So it will be helpful for you in your cybersecurity management also, okay, in your company. If you are working in the API production itself, it will be helpful for you. You can make use of this particular knowledge in your testing procedures also. You can make use of it in, and you can check for it, and you can do execute it. You can execute it and you can check for it, and you can use it in your company and your employees company also. Next one is from Nidhi. Okay, from will you be covering the API governance? Yeah, so we will be covering the API governance. It will be helpful for you. Yeah, it will be helpful for you in your business client also. You will be able to suggest it and you will be able to execute it. Okay, next one is from Pedro. So will you be able to explain in the Spain? Because okay, so we understand you are from Spain and you you want to take up our training. Okay, so basically we are having all the world languages. We are training in all the world languages. Okay, so basically global languages. So basically here you will be able to we will be training in you in your global language itself. Okay, we will be training you in the Spanish. If anyone is from Portuguese, like basically we will be training them in the Portuguese, English, Hindi. Okay, those all things will be there. Okay, so you will be able to learn in your regional languages also. Next one is from NG. So will it be useful for the WPTX exam? Yeah, so normally you will be able to use this particular course. So normally what happens when it comes to the APIs, they will be integrated with the web applications or mobile applications or any of the thick client applications, right? So basically you will be able to crack those exams with the help of that. Next one is for Victor. Okay, so will you be providing recorded sessions after completing the? Yeah, so normally recorded sessions are not the best thing from which you can learn. Okay, so normally previously we were trying to provide the recorded sessions, but due to some of the unethical ways which we have faced in our previous of our clients. Okay, so normally we are currently not providing, but what we will be doing is we will be providing you with several notes, and we will be providing you with all the materials that are needed for you to refresh your knowledge after 1 year also. Okay, and except that if you are having any of your errors or anything in that particular error or anything in any of your project or anything, so at that time you can directly contact us, and even after 1 year we will be happy to help you in any of the programs or any of your errors, or just to solve all of your queries. Okay, next one is from Nicholas. I'm preparing for international web security related exam, is it? Yeah, so normally if you are preparing for those old exams, so normally this particular course will be helpful for you for those exams, because we know that all the APIs will be connected, right? So basically there will be some of the queries where there will be the integration of APIs, and they will be asking for those type of things. Okay, ultimately our main goal is to crack those exams, right? So basically we'll be helping you for cracking those exams as well. Next is from Jason. So I have a project related to API. If you and your company is suggesting, yeah, sure. So basically if you are having all the if you are having the projects related to API, VAPT, Z teams, okay, any of the mobile pen testing and web pen testing, okay, so basically we are also taking up the projects, okay, and you have seen our quality, right? So basically we have already seen the vulnerabilities where we can bypass, we are that much securing the scenarios where we are bypassing those type of things also, right? So at that time, we will be taking up all the projects. We will be helping you to secure your organizations also. Okay, and you can send us the email or you can check up with our from our team itself, from our website itself. Okay, we will be connecting with you, and we will be securing your organization also. So next one is from Anand. So how much is for the fees, right? So basically the fees is similar. Basically the fees are much more less than if you compare it with the quality. Okay, so that all things, if you will be getting up from that particular course module itself. Okay, so our fees is currently $100 or 6,000 rupees. Okay, so you can check it in the course module itself. Okay, so those all things are given, those all things are mentioned there also. Okay, so here you can see the $100 or 6,000 rupees. So next one is from Samay. You are looking for the webinar. Okay, so basically, yeah, we are giving the trainings on all of the things for webinar, for the API testing, Android pen testing, malware analysis, okay, bug bounties, Android bug bounties, and web bug bounties. So we will be taking those all webinars in our future sessions. Okay, but for that we will need your support. We will need your feedback that how is our initiative, because we have taken up this initiative where we will be teaching you in 2 hours webinars how the advanced type of exploits and advanced type of vulnerabilities. So basically this is the first thing that is coming up in the cybersecurity world, right? So basically we will need your support. You can support us, you can go to our LinkedIn page, you can give us your feedback, you can message us, you can go to our YouTube page, you can support us there itself. Okay, so we will be excited for taking up more sessions. We will be excited to taking up more webinars. We will be excited to take up all those trainings also. Okay, we have planned to do these webinars on the regular basis. Okay, where we will be explaining you all those topics. Okay, so this was the last. So anything else, if you are having any other queries regarding anything, you can ask me. Otherwise we will conclude our session, and after that you can go through the syllabus, you can go through our website, and you can check for it. Okay, no questions, right? Okay, sure. So thank you all. Actually I'm really happy to get up to get this particular response. Okay, so from within first 2 minutes only there were more than 100 people who have joined. Okay, but because of this Zoom there are only 100 limit. I think we are getting the messages from almost other people to get into this particular webinar, but due to this limit we are not able to get it. Okay, we will try to use this recorded session. We will try to share you this particular knowledge in YouTube or in the LinkedIn. You can go through there, and anyone who is not joined, you can make use of it. You can learn all the things from us. Okay, but for all the ones who are joined, okay, you are very good. Like you have taken up task, and you have learned all those things. Okay, so basically I'm happy to teach you. Okay, and next thing, if you want to contact me, you can go up to our training sessions. You can go up, you can directly, there everything will be mentioned. You can search up there and you can check for us. You can contact us from there itself. Okay. So now we will be concluding our session. Okay, so after that, your next step will be contacting us. You can join us there itself. Okay. So bye everyone.